Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the last part of our summit. What you see here are four eminent persons. They are Dutch, they are gray, but not old. So, and one is saying he's not gray, so that's good. What I would like to do is to engage you in a discussion, ladies and gentlemen. And I don't think that the way you sit in the hall is appropriate for this. So I would like to invite all the people sitting in the back to stand up and come to the front. That gives you the opportunity to look the panelists into the eyes and to see if the answers are true and coming from the heart. So please join us. This is your opportunity to sit in the first row. Oh, there are seats over here. No. I will explain in a second from now why not. So what we would like to do is get an answer to all the open questions that are left during the discussions today, but not so much content-wise, but more in terms of how are we going to make this work together. And all these four eminent persons, they represent a part of Dutch society that can help us to make this work. So I would like to introduce the persons for you from left to right. So at the left, there is Inold Lagendijk. He is a professor of computer science at Delft University, but he is here today to speak on behalf of NWO. Welcome, Inold. Next to him is René Penning de Vries. We know each other already for a very long time, René, but we are not going to bother the audience with that. René is the figurehead of ICT in the Netherlands. He reports directly into the administration of economic affairs. So this is the guy that has the money. The next person is Arnold Smulders. He's a professor at the University of Amsterdam. He also plays an important role at CWI. And he's here on behalf of Comet. So Arnold is already, let's say, managing big programs in the Netherlands on ICT. I remember the first time when we met, that was in the Multimedian context, a very fine program, which is a kind of successor, you could say, to Comet. You see this pile of booklets. It is the reporting of Comet on data science, and I can assure you it's a lot of projects. So Arnold is here to tell us how a big national project should be run on data science. And then, last but certainly not least, is Erik Vladeres. Erik is with TNO, but he also holds a teaching position as a part-time professor here at our university. Erik is, as we call it, high up in TNO. He runs part of the ICT cluster together with Arnold Stocking. And so in this ballpark of, let's say, moving towards a third-generation university, there is valorization issue is a very important one, and I would like to invite Erik to say a few words, to take a position on that. And do it before you stand up, Erik, I would like to explain to the audience how we are going to do this. So normally there is this board session where these people look at each other and don't know what type of questions should be posed. So we now, because there are no questions coming from the audience, and you are there's no reason to believe that you are a different audience. So what we did is we are going to invite these persons to give us the questions. And we do that by giving them one by one the opportunity to stand up, approach the bench, as we call it, and show us in 10 minutes of time what their perspective is. And very many of these persons also prepared questions related to that. And then you can fire back. So first, we are going to listen to the four presentations, and I'm almost sure that there is enough stuff then to react on. And I'm challenging you, so take a notebook and the stilo and write down what you don't like about what they say and bring it up in 40 minutes from now. So that's how we are going to do this. Erik, you are first, so please give us your story.
Emil. This works. So I was here just before the break, and my first observation is the room is half as full as before the break. So hopefully the rest comes in. TNO's perspective on big data. Besides being a professor here in Eindhoven, I'm principal scientist at the TNO, and the lower part is the lead scientist early research program, sense making of big data. And that will be on the last slide, so I'll keep the tension for a while. Basically, my 10 minutes are divided in three parts. The first part is about Europe. Horizon 2020, I think most of you are aware of the program, probably already have a project running or you have submitted a proposal. The second part takes the perspective of TNO. We think big data started recently. I would like to say that otherwise, maybe we didn't use the word big data, but I would say about 10 years ago, we started with things that are now called big data. So TNO's view on big data, past to present. And the last slide is what will be in the future, and this is also a reach out to universities like Eindhoven and others to join us in the effort to make big data really big. So Horizon 2020 is a program that is say independent from a particular directorate. It's divided up into three key pillars: societal challenges, leaderships in enabling and industrial technologies, and excellence in science. And we were asked, we as the advisory forum to DG Connect, a group of about 25 to 30 people spread across Europe, to assist DG Connect, basically the placeholder for ICT research in Europe, to what and how to include ICT in this program. And we should not look at excellence in science, but we had to devote ourselves to societal challenges and the LIGHT program, Leadership of Enabling and Industrial Technologies. Well, if you say ICT, you quite often also mean big data. It's not only big data, but there's a lot of big data. And whether it's big data or Internet of Things and what's on top and what is below, I don't want to dive into that discussion, but both of them, both topics play a very important role in our advice to the administration of the directorate, how to include ICT and how to work with ICT in both the LIGHT program and the Societal Challenges program. As you know, public-private partnerships have been an experiment from a few years ago within Horizon 2020 and before that in FP7. Future Internet may be known. This is a way that the Commission tries to include the industry and the research and technology organization throughout Europe to pre-program part of the Horizon 2020 programs or work programs. And one of the PPPs that recently started, October 13, is on big data. And the picture on the top is still Vice President Kroes, with Jan Sunderlin from T-Kinetics that officially launched the PPP Big Data. This is something we should be aware of, that this is going on, and how to connect to that. The business part basically comes from the ETP that is called NESI, maybe you know them. So what is, if you look in this program, Horizon 2020, what are key elements? Basically, this is a part of the advice that we gave. First of all, a number of key trends that we observed. Making sense of big data. It's not just about big data. I think the program today not only focused on big data and how to deal with big data, but also how to extract information, how to extract value from that. Well, making sense of big data, capture integration, analytics that are domain specific quite often, is an important trend that is, well, getting stronger and stronger. Quantified self. basically we're getting measured. Either we do it ourselves or we are being measured. We leave a trail, digital trail, and more and more. So the quantified self is an interesting and important trend as well. And then the Internet of Things, more or less quite tightly connected, in my view, to big data, that it overflows in cyber-physical systems, where everything that was not connected until now gets connected. You can influence it, you can monitor it, etc. Three important trends. And if you then look at how we extract from that important, say, messages to the research community and the business community, that they are related to the following four research focal points. First, post-processing is not the answer. We have to go to real-time event processing. They are very complex, many streams come together. You have to go to real-time complex event processing and archiving. You have to go from monitoring to prediction. So predictive analytics and decision automation. Decision automation is in the area of value creation. There, if you can have strong prediction and strong decision automation, you really create value. Of course, when you say big data, you also say security and privacy, cybersecurity, privacy related. That should be basically by design. A recent note from the Ministry of Economic Affairs also states that again. And then standards and interoperability. When you big data basically connects organizations together, and if you want to do that properly, you have to talk the same language on a number of levels. So standards and interoperability. If you look at application domains, you can choose them quite broadly within Light. The transfer of results from, on the one hand, the Light program, so the more, say, generic program, to the societal challenge is really a challenge in itself. How do you move people that are active in ICT research to also societal challenges, which are, well, to some less challenging on an ICT level? I think it's not true, but we have to make them challenging. So let's move to TNO, to our perspective on big data. And this example, I don't know whether you've come across this picture. This is from 2005, where we started with dike monitoring. This is a topic in the Netherlands already for centuries. You don't have to explain outside the Netherlands that we're good in water management. This is a dike full of sensors, and we can predict when it's going to break, and also when it's not going to break. So you can create quite a lot of value from the data that you get from all these sensors and turn into information. We also have now these type of dikes in the Yellow River in China. We also have them in just outside Russia. So other example, Big Davids, where we try to have a lot of sensoric information turn into advices. So that might be from something like the Apenhul, where we have a lot of monitoring of gorillas, where you can enjoy the public, but also create value for specialists on animal monitoring. The SWELL project, I already mentioned, or perhaps I didn't, the COMET SWELL project, a large program. Well, Arnold can also say something about that. This is about stress monitoring, which we are doing together with, for instance, Philips, Almende, and other universities. Dark web, that's the other side of the internet. A lot of big data is being monitored there to somehow catch people that you would like to catch. We have a project together with a number of cybersecurity companies there. Infonomics, this is a Dutch type, I'm sure you understand what is on it. You want to create value from data and information. Quite often this data is not easily captured into euros. So if I can save you from traveling to the hospital, what does that save the society? Can you transfer it into euros? And even more important, can you make an investment out of that? That's quite a difficult challenge. Kate, that's together with RTL Nederland, Bioradar, and Prime Data, where we monitor quite a number of people moving around with their cars and give travel experiences much better than TomTom does. and smart dairy farming, which is a very large consortium dealing with the health of cows. If you look at a current farmer, I'm sure they have to study electrical engineering or something like that, or informatics for that matter. There's a lot of data going on, and this is really focused on the quality of milk, but also on the quality of the life of cows. So, the smart dairy farming project that I finish with is a project that was finalized in 2014, at least the first phase. The second phase will start next year. So what will be our outlook to the rest of say, 2015 and further? If you look at through your, if you look, say, broadly to the project that I looked at, you see a kind of simplified big data ecosystem. You have a data provider that creates data, and with that you can create information by extracting meaning. You have a service provider that creates services on top of that, that is delivered by a service consumer, by a consumer of the service. That might be a company, that might be you, and that in this way it is created value. That's a quite simple but it's quite useful way of looking at your ecosystem. We have used two cases, logistics and personalized health, to create a large program, about 2.5 million euros, calling Making Sense of Big Data. And what we want to do that is, besides doing research, also reach out to the community, the university community within and outside the Netherlands. So what is the community within TNO, what is the community within universities within the Netherlands, but also how to connect this to this PPP of big data, and how to connect to a number of valorization programs like the big data Doorbraak project. So basically, to conclude, the reach out to you, how can you connect to this mission? How can we make this a better program as just alone? Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Erik. So you can write down your questions to Erik. And in the meantime, we invite Arnold to share with us the lessons he learned or took away from the COMET endeavor. Ik denk dat dat.
Yeah. 3 years ago, the 110 million euros, 50 million by the government, 30 million by industry, and 30 million by knowledge institutions throughout the Netherlands. Some of them are displayed below here. Philips, you may know, TNO, you know, but Infosys, for instance, is a very large company established in India. 150,000 people work there. They've started a Dutch branch and they are also participating. Our mission is to deliver world-class ICT research. That's basically the mission, and to make it useful to our partners. And the partners, most of them are high-tech, but yesterday also KLM joined COMET, so not all of them are high-tech per se. Usually we make the best connection with people in a high-tech part of the company. KLM is interested in security networks. That's their purpose of participating. As Emil explained, we had a technology show, and basically over the 3 years of the program runs, it became more and more apparent, it wasn't intended that at the start, that big data is our main concern. Not everybody is working in COMET on big data, but the vast majority it is. And so we had this technology show, there's a booklet. We try to make it as accessible as possible, not only for the general public, but also for people who are strategic position. And the only thing that remains from the show is the booklet, of which I have a few spare copies. It was full of live demonstrators. And one of them is, for instance, to monitor group emotions, or, as I will show in a moment also, what music is playing in the world right now, or a solution for diabetes monitoring. So a variety, not one type of application, because basically we're interested in ICT science, which has more than one application area. And so we stay on the science side, and we are interested in, can it be applied in three completely different fields of use. This is the monitoring of the music in the world. Let me see if it runs. This is it's not an actual demo, but it's a video of a demo as it runs real time. And basically what it does is it browses through social media in all its imperfect way of information, and then whatever is tweeted about, we try from another source to come up with the music, and then the music is displayed. And in this way you can sort per country or per region or per musician. You can record its actual use in the world right now. So if you take it to be that what is tweeted about is also proportional, you could see that whenever there's an event around a person or a pop group, or you see a peak in performance, it's not very well. And so this is basically the tableau of the most popular songs in the world at that moment. And at that moment, it was 3 months ago, they had browsed 80 million of these things. From an ICT science point of view, this the interesting thing is to do for imperfect but abundant amounts of information, to find the trends and to be sure and to gather information sources. This is another project, works on geospatial databases. Now, in a normal database, you can't ask the question, what is close to something else? But in this database, you can. And basically, one of the main partners here is TomTom, who record this everywhere. And as you know, you don't have to buy companies that make maps. You make the map of Europe yourself by simply recording where cars drive. That's a very good approximation to what is currently a map. The demands here are stressing the ICT science in the size of the fact that the data are real-time, very big, and should be updated. And there is geospatial data. Okay. This is another result we've booked. If you have a very large pile of data, the pictorial data that is, and you want to search through it, that's basically, then Google says, well, that's easy, because I look at the annotations of the picture, and then other people tell you what will be in the picture. But we solved it differently. We only looked at the bytes of the data, only the pictorial bytes, and then from examples we learned to recognize. That led to a spin-off company. The spin-off company led to an app where on the app all your photographs you've recorded are sorted automatically without any typing. And then the app was published, and then a weekend later someone from Japan told how beautiful she liked the app, actually. Well, this is my, I think it's my data set, you see, or her data set, sorry. You see outdoors, this is her photos of food, and so on. This is advertisement, because she's a technology blogger. The app led to a spin-off, and the spin-off this summer led to, bought by Qualcomm, which is the largest chip producer in the world. So digital images is really a very hot topic, to which we luckily have contributed. This is the Infosys project. There are plugging people with all sorts of gadgets and then monitoring your health while jogging. this is our project with the Rijksmuseum. They want to do crowdsourcing, and the problem, this is another video, if you want, develops a little bit slow, but basically they have enormous amounts of art artifacts, and the question is, can we annotate them all? No, we can't. So how do we know that what people in the web say about this is really true or not? And the problem is then knowledge verification from uncertain sources. So the trend, basically, it wasn't planned that way, but the trend in comet data is that we have either uncertain or unspecified or other sensory data than usual, and we explore them to derive data from them. So this is emotion recognition, another spin-off activity. I won't go into detail there. But it appeared on the French television. And finally, this is if you have large unstructured archives, for instance, a set of Excel sheets as they developed over time, and you don't know anymore what exactly is described in the Excel sheets, can you then still derive, structure it, and derive knowledge from it? That's what they do at the Free University very well, actually. And Dance there, that is the archive of the Royal Academy, who has lots of these piles of unstructured digital data, as unstructured as their paper data. This is my one thought. Well, as we all know in the room, that computers develop exponentially. They double their performance every 2 years. And it still seems to be that this will hold on for a while. And data do the same, but they do it every year in the sense of the capacity. Now, if you believe with me that every capacity will be used, then this basically will create a new phenomenon, because the fact that the data, the difference between two exponential curves is another exponential curves. So the data will outgrow the ICT, and basically ICT is busy to strangle itself by creating so much data we can't process anymore. Exponential curves are very hard to understand for managers. They think that if you double the capacity that you solve the problem, but the problem is here, you have to double the capacity every year. So that's why I think that after this, say 8 years from now, there is a total different view on data, and data science will outperform ICT science. Well, that's my introduction. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think that the last part of Arnold brought in was how to deal with the exponential complexity and the self-strangulation of ICT is at least something that challenges you in a way, I hope. So we now move to Inald. Yes.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Inald.
Yeah.
Shall I plug this in somewhere? Oh, okay. So I'm here to talk about big data from the NWO perspective. And as you all know, NWO funds excellent research. And the field of big data is a field where a lot of excellent research is already happening and is going to emerge in the coming years. Why? Because big data leads to big questions. And big questions is what NWO wants to fund. By the way, I have many other roles in the Netherlands, but let me take here just a role from NWO. So if you want to know something else, we can also talk about it, but here I'm representing NWO. Big questions. So big questions actually in big data, we've seen a lot of them here today, but arise in many other fields as well. And every time it turns out that if you talk to different specialists from different fields, whether they are from computer science, whether they're from humanities, from social sciences, from physics, I don't care. They come up with a list of questions about and remarks about what big data is, and they sort of agree on what the problem is. And the problem Arnold just showed, this picture, but this picture at the same time with the two curves diverging seems to emphasize the fact that the data is growing very rapidly. But there's much more to it. And if you sample the field and if you talk to people, and I'm sure also this audience, a lot of other aspects are also playing a role. It's not just volume. If it's just the volume, maybe you can buy faster computers, which is typically an answer that you would get, for instance, from the physicists. Our problem is a lot of data. Give me money, I buy a bigger computer, and my problem is solved. In big data, I think the story is also different in the sense that the data is difficult. It's heterogeneous, it's complex, it varies over time. Accuracy is a problem, completeness is a problem, data might be distributed, all these aspects play a role, and the combination of that, that's where the big challenges and the big questions are. Now, if you think about big data and the challenges, then I think it's good to make a separation in four quadrants here, each leading to different types of challenges from an NWO perspective. On the top row, you see, let's say, the focus of the research. Is the research that you're looking at, the big questions, do they relate to research with big data methods? So you have methods available and you make use of those to solve problems in a certain field? Or are you looking at research that are on big data methods? So many of the things we heard today about algorithms, about process mining, are projects that look at big data methods as such. So it's good to make a difference between those two. And then on the vertical axis, we have the difference whether you want to apply these techniques or develop these techniques for the sciences or for, let's say, top sectors. I mean, then take sciences and top sectors here in a very generic fashion. Of course, we can make it far more detailed, but then this array or this matrix will have far more than four cells. Now, if you cross those four cells, then you get four different challenges. On the top left, if you cross research with big data methods in sciences, then often we are after intellectual value, understanding things. I'll show you an example in a sec. If you apply research with big methods in top sectors, then we're often after money. And we've heard a couple of examples here today as well. If you cross research on big data methods with sciences, then we're talking about, you know, how to store data, how to deal with data, how to protect data, what are legal aspects of data, what are trustworthy aspects of data. And then on the bottom right, and many of the talks here today were about that as well, if you cross research on big data methods in top sectors, then you get the data science and the data technology, really the hardcore algorithms, how can I understand data? So that's what we have here. I have four different areas, each with their own, let's say, take on what big data is. And as I said, when you talk to different, let's say, disciplines or different communities that NWO tries to serve, you get different answers and different challenges. I mentioned them already, a couple of them. For instance, research with big data methods in sciences. It's about understanding, for instance, astronomy or understanding challenges in humanities or understanding challenges in biology, the building stones, the building bricks of life. If you go to the right-hand side, research on big data methods in sciences is about stewardship, challenging challenges, protecting of the data, accessing data, legislation, etc., etc. Well, you can read the other examples for yourself. When Arnold just gave a couple of examples in the previous presentation about the COMET program, many of the examples were from the bottom two rows. Technology, science being developed on the right-hand side and being applied in different directions of top sectors. So looking at this big field, looking at the different takes on big data, NWO said, well, you know, if there's so many different views on big data, maybe we should develop a program that crosses all the disciplines in NWO. And that is now on the table. Actually, there's more of those programs, but this is definitely one of the six that there are currently now, the NWO Grand Challenge on Big Data. So this is going to be, in the coming years, to be developed a cross-disciplinary research program where all these different aspects are going to be addressed, addressing the common facets of big data in these different disciplines. So that's going to be a very exciting type of program where all these different disciplines come together and try to converge on those things that are in common, and that all of those four factors that are needed, economic value, intellectual value, the stewardship, protecting data, etc., and understanding the data, as for instance Eric Vladeris also clearly addressed, all come together. How to do this is not easy, and that is one of the questions that I have for you to come up with ideas of that. What is, oh, by the way, there's text about this as well. It's a very, it's in Dutch for the moment. It's a fairly compact piece of text, so this is not intended to read, just to remind me that text is there. It will be available from the NWO site. I don't think it's right, it's already there, but it will be soon. So if you're interested in reading this text and seeing this picture, let's say, developed, please go to that site. What is all this going to develop? Well, of course, a lot of scientific progress, a lot of, let's say, opportunities for economic value, a lot of opportunities for intellectual value, but also this. And I'm sure that this has been addressed here as well. People who understand this, who understand the common facets in data science, data technology, and the four different aspects. So this person here at the middle is supposed to be the data scientist, a new generation, multifaceted. You have to understand all the four corners of this picture. And not only in research, but clearly also in government, in companies, and in education. So this is one of the important, I would say, outcomes of such a program, that we educate these people, scientists at all different levels that will find their way into the different sectors of society. Well, having said that, I have two questions for you. So assume that I have money in my pocket, as NWO... assume, yeah. It's not there yet, but let's say. And if you see these four different challenges to the different disciplines that exist in NWO, across all the range, as I said, from social sciences all the way to the hardcore physics, from humanities to earth sciences, etc., etc. And we see that these have so many in common. What, according to your perspective, so from your point of view, should we prioritize in developing such a program? What are, according to you, the important aspects that should be present in such a program? And also, what are the conditions to make such a program work? In other words, how should we shape the collaboration within such a program, within the universities, with companies, with governments? So I'll leave that open as a challenge to you, and I'm looking forward to reactions from the audience or from my colleagues here at the table. Thank you very much.
Yeah, very clearly said. So this is an important issue, ladies and gentlemen, because the prerequisite that Inald made, that there, assume that there is money in the pocket. Well, there is money in the pocket. So we have an opportunity to spend it here, but we should be doing it wisely. So we will get back to that later. Thanks very much. So finally, René, we are going to say this only once.
Two introductory remarks to make. First of all, I don't have slides, which is, I guess, fine. And the second remark is I don't have money either, which is... maybe we can do something about that. Let me start with a question. How many people do we have here in the audience that relates to the industry, that is from the industry? Well, that's an amazingly high percentage, about half. About half. And I'll explain to you later on why I asked that question. The second question is, how big do you think is the national Dutch economy? So the gross national product that we have here in the country. Well, give me a number. 300? 700? Yes, about 650 billion. And out of that 650 billion, ICT is about 6%. And I think that's an amazingly high number. Not many people realize that. And not here in the audience, I guess, but certainly not in Den Haag. So the impact of what we are doing in the ICT domain at this moment is about 35 billion. And there's another staggering number, which is the compound growth. So if you look at the annual growth of the last 6 or 7 years, it's about 8%. Now, we struggle and we scramble to get a percentage, a growth percentage of about 0.5%, and maybe we do it very good, then we go at 0.8. But the ICT domain, which is a little bit largely defined, but the ICT domain does about 8% and does that for the last 8 years. And I quote here from a report that Dialogue made, which is a pretty serious company. And of course, you can always argue, should it be 8, should it be 7? But it's very, very significant. And yet, the fear is, and that's the reason that the minister asked me to step in as ICT figurehead. I hate that word, by the way. So never, ever use it again, Emil, if ever you want to get some subsidy. So there is an opportunity, which is tremendous, and the question is whether we are well aligned in our corporations and in our programs to grasp that opportunity. And we know for sure that if there's one thing that characterizes the digitization of the society, it's the tremendous speed. Something happens and you don't see it, it's a little bit deceptive, and suddenly, wow, it starts to be disruptive. We've seen it many, many cases, many, many industries have been through that challenge. The finance industry is about to see the same rapid changes, and we don't believe it, and we don't prepare ourselves, and suddenly it's there. So the fact that we are pretty, actually, we score pretty well as a country in all kinds of ICT rankings doesn't mean that we're going to be there in 5 years from now or in 10 years from now. So in the World Economic Forum list the other day, I think we scored fourth, which is very respectable. But it is shaky. It can change overnight. So that is a reason that in Den Haag people felt, well, maybe we should give a little bit more exposure to ICT and get a little bit more interaction and a little bit more, tangible programs, tangible efforts that make us believe that we're going to be at the same position or even higher in a number of years from now. I have a number of things which I would like to say to you. So, I spoke about the value or the size of the ICT industry in the Netherlands. There's also a few areas which are absolutely world-class. And I must say that I grew up here in this area, at the more hardware side of the high-tech. I didn't even know. So the AMSX, the Amsterdam Internet Exchange, is one of the biggest data ports that we have in the world, which is amazing. And the fact that there's quite a few companies who decide to put their secondary office or a development office in Amsterdam is, of course, related to that fact. And you may have seen that Uber today announced that their development lab, next to the one in San Francisco, is going to be in Amsterdam, which is fantastic. Booking.com, in spite of the fact that it's a pretty much an international company these days, it is in Amsterdam. And it has to do with a number of elements, but certainly also with the fantastic infrastructure that we have over there. And I must say, to me, that was kind of a surprise. So we need to keep that going. We need to find ways to make sure that we keep those elements at the same level as we keep here the A50 and the A1. So we spend easily €1 billion on a few kilometers of freeway. And if it comes to a tenth of that amount for a very high level infrastructure, we have a difficulty to take that decision. And I think we can only change that if, as a community, we make our points very clearly and step up and say, this is what we need. Because now I come to the not so fantastic story on ICT in our country. It is pretty much fragmented. So the same dialogue survey that I referred to asked to the community which comes together in Nederland ICT, 44,000 companies, many ZZPers and many small companies, but also the big ones. Eh? So the Ordina's and the Pinkelkades and the Logica's. So that is collected in what we call Nederland ICT. A number of questions. One of the questions was, where do you get your knowledge from? So how do you make sure that you remain up to date on all these fantastic developments? Now, and I tell you, it was just an embarrassing answer. Only 8% of these companies feel that they get a knowledge influx from our university community. It's an embarrassment. And of course, there's people who get educated and they move to the industries, and that is a very effective source of information. But if you ask those guys, do you feel that this university community has any value to you? If I rephrase it, the answer is no. And yet we have 150 in Holland, we have about 150 professors with teams who all claim they have a fantastic job. And I'm sure they have. But yet the connection to a big part of the industry is lost. And the fact that, you know, Philips has this nice flagship initiative is great, but in itself it's a shame that it took so long to get this done and suddenly everything has to happen and we have a big project. And what about the other industries in Holland? Eh? Are they equally well preparing themselves for what is going to happen? So those are the two elements. So on one hand, there's an upside that is certainly going to be there, and it could be based upon the fantastic infrastructure that we have here in the country. And on the other hand, there is certainly in the ICT domain, there is a, how to say that carefully, there's a possibility for better cooperations. Now, that leads to my three questions, and I listen carefully to Emil, otherwise he gets angry. I have three for you. So this 8%. The 8% industries that feel that they have something, that they use the knowledge base that is available in the infrastructure, the knowledge base that is available at the universities in an effective manner. Eh? How can we improve that? So why not 80%? Why not 50%? And I don't care about the number, but it's the mentality. Eh? So why not change our mentality, change our way of working, so that the entire industry would be really enthusiastic about all what we are all doing in our institutes. It would help the funding situation quite a bit, by the way. That's one. Second question. So I heard a lot this morning, and actually I was felt very pleased with the fact that you can learn, even if you're an old guy in the meantime. But I wonder, is the data stewardship concept, is that well enough in your program? So if we have all these fantastic solutions and we don't care about privacy and we don't care about security and liability and ownership and all those elements that start to be big now in Den Haag, if we're not at least think about those, now we may be in for a cold surprise that in the end is not going to be accepted. If you've seen the last couple of days on the news, the situation of the children in the schools that appear to have all their data collected somewhere with some of the publishers. Now, that is a few things which I believe, if that's repeat itself a number of times, it will slow down big time the opportunities that we will have to introduce big data-based solutions. So is that stewardship element, is it well enough connected in your programs? A question to the Data Science Initiative. And the last but not least, and I echo the question that Inald raised, if we believe that big data has to be cross-fertilized with an application domain before it can create value, what are those domains in the Netherlands? So what are those cross points where we are credible in the sense that we have a heritage, we have knowledge, we have expertise. Which domains are sustainable, which are... So what are the areas where we justifiably can claim that we can be the leaders in the field in the next couple of years? So, three questions. 8%, stewardship, and those cross areas where you can make a difference.
Thank you. Excellent, excellent. So I think, ladies and gentlemen, that there is a strong connection and also a build-up in the stories. So I think that Eric has created a European venue. Arnold has proven that a lot of good work is going on. So if those 8%, or I should say the 92% that are not served, would say, what is there to take over? I would say that the pile of activities that come from Comet is an excellent start to show at least what can be done. And there is, of course, more. And then, indeed, the combination of the questions that you raised, René, and also Inald came up with, I think that this cross-fertilization is a very strong asset to build on. That should be enough, ladies and gentlemen, to tackle your brains. So here we engage in the part of the discussion where you can give the answers rather than posing the questions. So, let's start with a simple one then. Let's start with the question, how can we improve the 8%? And that's not the CAGR that you refer to. That will go up as well if we also can raise the 8% of the amount of companies that feel supported. So, you are too fast. You are a professor, you will always question whether or not the figures are right. So, but let's start with the 50% in the audience that represents a company. Who are these people? So raise your hands again. Who of you are within the 8%? So this is interesting. So it's 8%. Yeah. So what happens to the rest? So who could open the discussion? Why are you here today and yet not feel served apart from the free lunch that you got? So who would like to comment on this? Go ahead, please. There is a person with a mic, so you can speak up. Please go ahead. It goes on. It should be on. It takes time. We have slow electricity. Yeah, please go ahead.
So I am from the industry. I have like 5 years of professional experience in software development. I've been working
Just quit my job, so I'm not speaking for Finn anymore, but so this is my background, web development, large-scale systems, stuff like that. My industry is served, knowledge-wise, it's served by community. So there are some companies organizing events, there are community-organized events, there are meetups, there are... Most companies I know organize internal events where people share knowledge, where they invent external speakers. I have never met someone from a university at any of those events, never. I do show up at events like this every now and then. I am sort of a academic, like I'm a chemical engineer by education, but I like an academic environment, so I tend to show up sometimes, but I haven't seen much interest from the academic world in my world, ever.
Also would like to react, not as a counter part, but the, again this question, how do you feel as a company discarded by the academic world? You would like to comment on this?
Yes, please.
Maurice. Yep. Can we go to this person first? Okay.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I think for myself that if we are... saying that we are on a point in time that there is a revolution going on and a paradigm shift, that one of the things that we should emphasize is the entrepreneurship. And I think in this time, Holland, which is, I don't know the English word, but overleg economy, is too slow. And what you see is now that America is much, much faster. And so if we want to have more relation between the industry and a university, don't put it in large programs on which companies has to write down a proposal to get into it. Just let the market and the new entrepreneurships and the young people that start those startups do their work. And you see in the USA that there is a mixture between government money and private money, and it's working very good. So let that power do its job.
Yeah. That's a good point. But do we have the skills at the university? So not in terms of let's say, the scientific background, but in terms of meeting the statements that you made in terms of entrepreneurship.
In all schooler systems, put the entrepreneurship in it. There are many big owners of companies that say that the entrepreneurship in Holland is too less educated.
Yeah, that's a good point. Does this excite you, René?
No, it doesn't excite me, to be honest. But of course, there is some truth in what you're saying.
Yes.
But so actually the fundamental question is whether we believe that the, shall I say, the companies that are unified in Nederland ICT, whether they feel that innovation for them is essential, yes or no. So if it is not, then who cares? But I think I see that that company, that entire industry is being commoditized very, very rapidly, which means that the prices go down and the industry will face a very difficult time. Now, the classical recipe in such a situation is to innovate. Now, what the solution is, yes, we need more entrepreneurship, and I don't know, but I just invite you to think about that. So first of all, is it true, the assumption that industry is being commoditized? Mm-hmm. And secondly, do you want to get out of that situation? So maybe... Okay.
There are some questions over here, maybe in the middle also. Could you... Yeah, go ahead, please.
I'm also from industry, and I very much agree with the earlier comment that I think also in today I see a lot of the traditional industry, Philips, T&O, the traditional players, also in the collaborators. What I'm missing here today are the WizKids, the young people, but also the Googles and the bigger companies. So I think there the innovation will come from. You have that seen in the past in the pharma. Yeah? So you see now that all the big pharma companies, they only look into the startups and to the small companies for innovation. It doesn't come from them anymore. And I expect that's partly the same in the whole ICT area.
It didn't put them on stage, but I'm sure that there are WizKids in the audience. Who feels like a WizKid? So they are there.
Few. I see much more grey people, and I'm grey myself as well. So I'm not disqualifying anybody.
Just pushing back a little.
So I feel also very grey and old. I think the innovation will not come from me. It will come from the young people, and I'm missing them.
Yeah. There is a lady that a WizKid even. She would like to comment on it. Could you move the mic over here, because this is where the buzz is. Thanks a lot. The lady would like to react.
Well, my experience, I started in academia, then I worked for 20 years as a commercial consultant, and I'm going to start next week with a PhD. And I think this is part of the answer to also the question, one of the questions that Inald had. Innovation is coming from young people. Innovation is coming... needs people with different insights, multidisciplinary approaches. So I think that why not create short educational programs for people to do after they have got a certain amount of practical experience. My background is in behavioral sciences, and I'm now going to do a PhD on process mining. And I think that's a good idea. Just make it easy for people to have lifelong learning, like MOOCs. Create such programs and fund that sort of things. Because then you have people who start with knowledge, They're young and innovative, and you stimulate continued learning and continued innovation.
Inald, does this turn you on? you represent
That's an indecent question, but...
Would you be willing to put money into this?
Yeah, I'd like to make a combination of some of the, the answers. I'm from academia myself, as you have guessed. I always thought when I was young and whiz, etc., that academia was a place where, you know, there was a lot of excitement and changes, etc. But being there for a long time, I realized that the institutions as such are pretty conservative. The work that is done is okay, but the changes take so much time. So all these ideas that I heard coming by require some changes. And the example that you gave is a change from the outside, where external people, after being in companies or society for some time, ask for more education. And you see that universities are responding to that. There are these professional masters that are coming up. So you already have a master in some field. You work in the field for 4, 5, 6, 7 years. And then you go back to school for, let's say, 2 years. And then that 2 years, you do a 1 year professional master. I think that's a new development. And that's also putting pressure on the existing system. So the change will come, you know, from the outside in a way. Yeah, let me leave it at that.
That's a good point. But then the question is, of course, will the universities then follow up on the request for the change, or will they back up and stay in their classical Humboldtian position? So
that's,
we have to work.
Yeah, that's a good question. I cannot predict the future.
No,
obviously,
yeah. I'm with you there. Yeah. Good point.
But I think universities should change, and there were already MOOCs mentioned and online education. Those are also catalysts for changes in the university. And you can see the excitement, or if you like, the turmoil, because this is an international competition now that we are facing. So yeah, something is going to happen, I'm sure. And maybe it's either, you know, go forward or die.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. And there was a question already by the gentleman who's really anxious to ask the question. So please go ahead.
Thank you. Well, I come from the commodity industry, where it's traditionally IT is always perceived as a cost and only support, rather than a business enabler that increases their productions or whatever. So it is most often the case that the IT in these such industry companies are not moving in the same velocity of changes in the educations or technology. So I think in one hand it is very important to, of course, to follow up with the technology and buzzwords and everything, but also it is also important to change the paradigm of these companies where this industry, that, hey, IT can do so much more to your company rather than supporting your business only. If that is achieved, I believe the interaction between university and the company will be much more, because the company itself will come to the university to acquire the new knowledge, because they believe in the idea of IT is much more. Thank you.
Are there any feelings?
So the litmus test often is, if you look into an organization, you ask yourself, where does the IT report? If it reports to the CFO, then you're in a commodity situation. If it reports elsewhere, then it is much more seen as a business creator. But we as a community, we need to also take that as an action item to ourselves. We sell ourselves extremely bad. If you look at it, the front page of the Telegraaf, of all newspapers, but if you do it anyhow every now and then,
left Dutch newspaper.
if there is a front page item on ICT, it's about cost, it's about the fact that the system doesn't work, it's about the fact that we can't have our tax system at the adequate level automized. So we don't do a good job in selling the story as Arnold just showed on all those fantastic crown jewels.
Arnold, what can we learn from you? So ICT is the bad news sector in the Netherlands. So how are you going to improve this?
I think it's important to make a distinction between high-tech solutions and low-tech solutions. And there's nothing wrong with low-tech solutions. If you look at the difference between Amazon at the time and Google at the time, then they grew up almost the same age. And Amazon was a low-tech solution, but the only innovation came from the business model they developed. And everybody living at that time could have generated an Amazon, but nobody believed it would be
feasible. He was ahead of his time a lot. But if you have a low-tech solution, that's easy to copy. So that's why low-tech companies of a certain size will always search for high-tech uniqueness. And Google, at the time, was the best search engine around, and they almost went bankrupt had they not in time developed also a business innovation by this advertising business, what's basically there now. And so I think that in the Netherlands, we try to sort of middle in between a little bit of high tech and a little bit of business innovation. And they don't last very long, these solutions, in the international competition. So yes, the climate in the Netherlands is changing in a few ways. For instance, academia has been very Calvinistic in the sense that academia is for Saturdays and Sundays. So basically, it's for fun and not for profit. And this, if you look at the papers, what the Royal Society writes about freedom of research, it's not a real opposition towards, you can have very good research and still have a inspiration from the market. So that has to develop in the Netherlands. And also, the same holds when I go around Amsterdam. I meet a lot of people who say either we buy technology from abroad, we deliver our data, and then Google knows more about the district I live in than the Dutch government. That cannot be go unpunished, so to say. So we have to adapt as a society as a whole, academia first, but also the industries, because complaining will not bring you any closer to the solution.
Suppose you would follow a very simple direction. Yesterday there was a television program on Dutch television looking at the stars. And what I recall from the astronomers, so our colleagues who on an individual basis spent the largest amount of money in science, they are very good at selling themselves and selling what they do. So would it help, in your opinion, Arnold, that we would have something like telling or looking at the data or telling stories about what we do when we do computing science? Would that help?
I don't think that will be, because astronomy fits in the Calvinistic model. It's basically useless. Yeah, and they spend 90 million euros of government money,
yeah,
and all of ICT spends 25
yeah,
each year.
I know.
So that's the Calvinistic model. And I don't think that as long as people have conquered the computer by themselves, they tell proud stories in this meeting in The Hague that I'm an ICT expert myself because I know how my iPad works. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's in that direction. I've noticed, however, that whenever we generate a spin-off or a high-tech spin-off, that arouses a lot of attention in the media. And so I think that we should go that way.
All right.
Because everybody has a computer, so it can't be too difficult to do ICT.
Okay, that's good. That's good. But so who would like to react on this?
Switched off. So I beg to differ a little bit. It's not either or. It should be and.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
It is fantastic if we have successful startups.
Yeah.
And that's, of course, a great success. But just telling the story, huh? So I happen to be in Den Haag quite often these days. It's just amazing how illiterate these people are if it comes to what IT is. So I gave an example the other day. I said all the implants, no, not all, but many of the implants these days that are used in the medical discipline are 3D printed. Now that is an ICT application, beautiful. And you need to scan, you need to manage that data, you need to feed it in one of the complex printing machines, and up there it is. So if we sell that more as an ICT application and not just as a 3D print hype, well, that type of thing, we need to be a little bit more smart in those elements.
Erik, you are burning.
Yeah, well, I want to follow up on this remark. I think when there is a success,
It's claimed by someone else. So it's either 3D printing, it's automotive, it's healthy aging, it is something else, it's not ICT. And on the one, I mean, that's an ambivalent feeling that I have. I think it's very, you can be very proud that you make others succeed. So let's be proud on that.
Yeah.
But let's steal a little bit of that thunder.
Yeah, but that's an interesting point, because it was also raised, one of the questions of René was that we should try to combine so this cross-area thing. So on the one hand side, develop the methods and the hardcore stuff, and then combine it with an application and make that work. That's basically what you are saying. And for the past 20 years, I have witnessed that in the Netherlands, ICT was an innovation axis, as it was called. And the result was that we as ICT innovators thought that we could contribute in any feasible domain, and we were never ever valued for it. So maybe also your point was addressing that the ICT sector as such should speak up, not as an innovation axis, but as an innovation sector of its own. Inhoud.
Yeah. So this reminds me of another discussion that I had some time with some of you. And if you look at, for instance, biology, then if I would ask any of you what is the challenge of biology, I think many of you would come up with an answer such as understanding life. Mm-hmm. And if I would ask you what is the purpose of astronomy, you would say understanding where the universe comes from. Yeah. And so for many disciplines, there's this, you know, very simple, basic question at the core that anybody would be able to reproduce. Now, if you take biology, then if you understand life, then in the long run, you'll have medicine that can cure certain diseases, etc. So there's also, let's say, an innovation aspect to that. If I would ask the same question, what is the, you know, at the core of ICT or big data, what is there? I get scattered answers.
There is at least one.
Yeah, answer. I know Arnold says, but he'll get the mic. You have your own mic, by the way. So take that one.
But
and we have been lifting too much on what you said, the use or the applicability, but at the same time, well, let me first give Arnold a mic.
Okay. Yeah, Arnold. Go ahead.
The most famous debate in the Greek philosophy was what is the nature of information and what is the nature of knowledge? And basically, we answer that. It's a little bit late. It's 2,500 years later.
But we are still in time.
But it's that's in time.
Excellent answer. Yeah.
So let's sell that.
All right.
I mean, that's the story that we have to sell.
Yeah, that's a good point. We go back to the audience. So who would like to step into the discussion from this point? So there are heard your opinion. We get back to you if no one else would like to react. So there is a person in the middle, and then we serve Edwin.
Finally.
Go ahead.
Well, hello. I'm a little bit of an outsider here. I'm from the Department of Industrial Design, where we go into neighborhoods, into the world, to talk to people and to see how they interact with technology and how we can present this value towards them. And I think I have looked around. I think I'm the only one here from that department. But we are for 2 weeks in the next building. So maybe they could help with selling this, sort of selling IT to the rest of the country. That's sort of a suggestion from my.
For us. So suppose,
all right.
No. Suppose you would pitch in an elevator one of the persons with the money. He would then say at the second floor going up, what is it exactly what you propose? What would you be doing? So you say, well, I can help you. So go ahead. What will you do tomorrow?
Well, right now I'm here to listen to your problems.
Yeah. Yeah, and you ate a free lunch, so that's enough.
Yes, thank you.
So what would be your answer to the question, how can we start tomorrow?
You say go to your audience. That's what he says. Go to your users.
Yeah. And how do you do that?
And leave this campus.
Yeah, but it's something like saying try to be happy. We all want that, but the question is how it is being done in practice. So we have to dive one level deeper into this.
Emil?
Yes.
I like your suggestion. If you take a few examples, let's take the first one that I took, the dike monitoring.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This basically started with our feet in the mud in Groningen, and I can assure you that is not nice. You have to drive there for hours and hours before you're there. You have to do that separately because you're not. You don't have any credibility if you go there to a dijkgraaf. Who are you to tell them that you can monitor a dike that they did for centuries? And you have to do this.
All right.
Otherwise, good they point. Won't believe you, and you will get back to yep. your nice offices.
Is this the type of concrete? Yep. Very good. Edwin, so could give the microphone to Edwin. Try to get it back. Go ahead,
get it back. No problem. Maybe one remark first, but I might be on slippery ground here. It's not just ICT data science, in my opinion. So I think the story should be a little bit bigger. But to come back maybe to the first one on the 8%, one of the things I was not trying to question the 8%, but trying to get more information, are those companies that are saying they are using the universities doing better than the other ones? Because if they are, apparently we are delivering something. If we are not, if they are not, then apparently we are doing the wrong things.
No, well, that's an academic response.
Can I then keep it, Emil?
Short reaction, René?
No, I think I'm done with my comment.
All right, okay. Who would like to react or open a new perspective? Please go ahead.
Well, it's a pity there's no answer on that. Then I will follow up on this. Okay. Who did you really speak? Because I'm also from an IT company, and perhaps that IT company was represented. But here there's lots of colleagues from me, and they were not over there in these discussions, but we are here. And I think there's more of those companies represented in this council or this ICT group that are unknown to the folks that are telling you these stories that there's no connection with universities.
Now, listen,
I think there's more.
Yeah, but you challenged me to make a comment, and I will.
Yes.
So you're in the audience. Of course, you're not a, how is that, we say that, a good steekproef.
Yeah.
Representative samples, because you are the believers. And in fact, the guys that we need to touch are the non-believers. And that is the other 44,000 that you don't see here in the audience. That's my point.
But I think what
and I do believe, yeah, by the way, that those 8% are a little bit at a positive side. And maybe it is because of the ICT. Maybe it is because those guys think in terms of innovation. And think in terms of value creation. And not just in terms of cost, as the other speaker just said.
All right. But that's then, okay, appealing to the more cultural thing within companies. Instead of using theorems like resources, we need data scientists to be stuffed in the black box and they come out with new valuable things. So it's more complicated than that.
Yeah, that's true. Okay. All right.
May I comment a bit on the 8%? And maybe I'm part of the 8%, although we can improve a lot because we are just started. But about selling ICT, in our journey, we had one of the topics, and it was called a customer journey. And we would like to go data mining and process mining. That was part of the proposal. And the proposal was rejected. And after a discussion, we came up with a new name, and it was data-driven value proposition. And then somehow managers started to think, hey, maybe this is valuable. Just an example.
Yeah, it's all the package, yeah. All right, Maurice, there is a gentleman over there. Are there other questions related to this very same subject? Yeah, there is a gentleman over there.
This gentleman was trying to get the microphone for a while.
Yes, thank you. My name is Peter Vraag. I studied mathematics in 87. After that, I started at TNO. I was working on wargaming. And then for me, it became clear that it was possible to train the army in the way of working, in the way of thinking. And 30 years later, I see pictures of the way we are working in companies. I see very based on data, founded in systems somewhere. But what we are not doing very good at the moment, I think, is that we ask the management, what are you going to do with your company? Give me your strategy, and I want to make a map for you, how you can achieve that goal. So that's what I'm trying to say is that we are talking about data science. I think one step above is applications, services. One step above is process. One step above is strategy. And I think when we want to achieve something big, then we have to develop a business TomTom like that. So not a TomTom that you are seeing right away at this moment, that you see the road, railroad, but you see everything on that in the TomTom that's hidden so far. And that's the reason that I think that many projects in ICT world failed, because nobody could see what everybody was thinking. Nobody could feel and touch what the picture the person has in her head. So what I'm trying to say is it possible to make one solution, one service that starts with a mind map, the mind map of you, for example, your individual companies. And that mind map you give to your project management. And that project management, they are working on it. And then, but you, every day, you see the picture. You see the pictures changing. From 3 blocks, you go to 4 blocks, for example. You see different sizes. Mm-hmm. You make a very good step.
I think so, you made your point.
There's
a second point. All right, you can make it.
The other problem is, what I want to mention first, is that when you watch the Standard & Poor's companies, the biggest 500 companies in the world, in the last 12 years, 50% of the companies quit. When you check the academic world, the map of the academic world, it's only growing. Is that logic?
That's logic, that's, but the difference, of course, is that you are publicly funded, and those companies have to make their own.
Yeah, they have to make money. Yeah, sure. So I think that's the
and
simple
on your
answer.
First point, I never would go for a very complex solution. I do believe strongly that the challenge is to bring together various disciplines. You have your language and your values in the ICT community, and that's not necessarily understood by other guys. So I challenge my collega Boegbeelde, so please come up with projects where the ICT community could have a significant impact. Now, I heard one or two suggestions. And it's simply because they believe out of agro or food or tuinbouw, creative, that there is no value in working with the ICT community, which I think is a big misjudgment. So we need to get those guys around the table in an environment that they try to understand each other, not just exchanging words, but trying to communicate.
But do we really need those guys to make our point?
Emil, what do you think?
Well,
let me give you one example, building on what Inal just said. In the life science area, there's a big initiative to make huge sets of data available for all kinds of researchers and product developers and companies. And that is totally unstructured, that is of a huge volume. All the questions that we discussed during the day are there. So how are we going to do that? Now the good thing is that out of that community, there is now a mindset that they need to be helped. And not just by a guy who did bioinformatics, but by hardcore IT experts. Now we're going to see whether that's going to work. But to me, that is at least a number of starting points which are very, promising. And now we have to see whether we can get that going. Okay. But that's one of those initiatives that could fit into Inal's NWO description. I think it would be great.
Yeah. Is that turning you on, Inal, such a proposition?
Why do you keep asking me this question?
Yeah.
Yes, this is an example. But as René said, this is one example. Yeah. And in talking about priorities, I'd like to hear also other suggestions maybe from the audience for different fields or different crossings of top sectors or societal sectors with ICT or data science challenges, where we as the Netherlands can make a difference, because that's important again in the international playing field.
Yeah, without addressing the classical industries.
Sure.
So we move to, there was a question over there. Please go ahead.
Hello, I work for IBM, so that's one of the larger ICT companies. Mm-hmm. What we have is that currently we are what we still believe is an information age. What we have seen today is that the amount of information is outgrowing the capacity to actually handle that information. So the information age is basically dying. The question is how long it will take. We have to move to something else. And I think what we have to move to is the creative age. We need creative people to come up with radically new solutions to the existing problems. One of the disadvantages is that over the last decades, the whole industry, the whole education programs have been killing off creativity. So what we have to go back to is basically go back to our inner child and be that young creative guy again, because all young children generally are a lot more creative, and be starting up again with these creative ideas. If, for instance, if you have a look at what we do with crowdfunding at the moment, that's where you see the creative ideas. Unfortunately, what happens if they become a little bit successful, large companies buy them, and basically they kill off all the creativity again. Yeah. So that's, I think, something where we should make a radical change, and that even starts with young kids, and let them be creative again.
Yeah. Would that be a solution to your question, Arnold, with respect to the differences in exponential growth? So not just try to keep up with the pace of the exponential growth of data, but become more creative. That's what the gentleman, in my view, is suggesting as an alternative.
Yeah, it's always a good idea in academia and also in industry to become more creative. I'm not sure, as an old man, I'd rather propose the following, that in a society there's a limited tolerance for radically new things. And so it is okay that you can't just radically renew everything. So if society picks up things, then it can, in this day and age, do it very quickly. For instance, the music industry was transformed in 5 years by the introduction of first the network and then the service on top of the network. That's incredible. You can't complain about that. And it's also incredible that the industry of the musicians has responded to it and still survived, because I know lots of industries who can't renew themselves within 5 years. So there is a good example. And I think the amazement, honestly speaking, to your point, is more the other way around. That there is a limit, you can't resolve, large industries are conservative by nature because they defend their position. But you can't just take away all the anchors of society. That is the other.
Okay. In view of time, there is time for one burning comment or question. Who is the poser of that question? There is someone soliciting here, someone over there. Let's start with the gentleman over there. Where is the mic? Oh, it's over there. And let's see how much time.
Okay, and then I will start my last remark. I have basically two remarks based on the 8% you mentioned. First of all, I think that not all IT industry should be served by the universities, or even could be served by the universities. I see a lot of my friends starting up just a software engineering company. They're basically building software or websites, making a lot of money. They don't need innovation from universities. They're just performing their jobs, and they don't need any more academic innovation. And second of all, I think that a lot of innovation comes not from scientific research, but just from great ideas, like the apps you have on your phone. You don't need a university to tell you how to do this, I think. In my opinion, if there's 8% of the business really having direct profit from universities, that's a great number, actually, I think.
Arnold, go ahead.
Basically, I agree with you. There's one extra point, that if a solution can be high-tech, then you are ahead of the competition, because low-tech solutions can be copied. There are also smart people outside the Netherlands. So that's the essential difference. But I'm pretty sure that for many solutions, say smart analysis of the problem is much more important, of a greater importance than the ICT solution afterwards. I agree with you. But high tech really pays off, because it brings you a competitive edge on which new essential ways can be explored. So there should be a balance. I agree with you that 8% is too low, but I would rate 50% as far too high. So, yeah,
what,
so...
What would you think is reasonable?
Now, it would be, if we have an open door policy where, say, 25% come in and out, that would be great. Yeah, so...
And if that would drive the 8% CAGR for another 15 years, we are done.
It's not about the percentage, it's about the awareness. Eh? And of course, depending on your particular business, you need to decide which way you want to go. But it seems to me that the 8% has room for improvement.
Yeah, but that's the agreement. So let's settle on this agreement then.
Emil, may I
yeah, sure.
make one remark?
The final word is
think
yours.
Not final, but
yeah, yeah.
What I think what you also said is you identified a mechanism how things work. If you've done a master training and you've done it well, for instance at Eindhoven University, then you can become a successful entrepreneur. If you're then questioned whether you have still you make use of knowledge from the university and of recent research, then your answer may be no, because I've had a good education. So this is also a way the mechanism works.
Yeah.
And part of the solutions may be high tech, but opposing you, Arnold, on this, high tech is not always an answer that a company can work with. It's also proximity. If I have a high tech solution, but I don't, and I, again, the dike example, and I don't go to Groningen and put my feet in the mud, then I can have an interesting high tech solution, but they take the person that goes to them.
Yeah, and that's about mentality and awareness again. That was also mentioned. All right, there is enough stuff, ladies and gentlemen, to keep in the air for the discussion. But not without a drink. I would like to close this day. It was a great day, at least I enjoyed it, and that is of course not the purpose of the day, but it's a nice benefit. I would like to thank the panel and ask you to give them a big hand. And I would like to thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being here today. Actively contributing to the discussions. So in addition to the free lunch, there are free drinks. They are served outside here, and I hope to see you again, at least at the summit next year, but hopefully much earlier. Thank you again for being here.